Hey, I'm Michael Hoff with Digital Theologian, and welcome to day 34 of 40 Days with Jesus. Today we are in John chapter 18, and Jesus gets arrested. Today's passage can be broken down into four basic segments. The first is the arrest of Jesus. Then we have Peter denying him once. After that, Jesus is brought before Annas, who has served in the past as a high priest and is in many ways running a pre-trial before Jesus ends up before Caiaphas. And then we come to the final segment for today, where Peter denies Jesus again. As we dive into this passage, it's important for us to pay attention to where Jesus is geographically, because it's a place that isn't named in John's gospel, but it shows up very prominently in the synoptics. John describes for his audience where Jesus is going, and if you were to follow from the temple across the Kidron Valley, right in that location, you find an olive grove, aka the Garden of Gethsemane. The Garden of Gethsemane in the Synoptics is a place of great internal turmoil for Jesus. He's wrestling with going to the cross and everything that faces him. He's recognized that the hour is come, and he has pulled his disciples around him to pray with him. They fall asleep. He's sweating drops of blood, right? This is an intense moment in Jesus' life throughout the synoptics. And yet here in John, Jesus has been troubled earlier, right? At the close of his public ministry, surrounding the time that Judas leaves to betray him. These are the moments when Jesus has been troubled. And so we see the same emotion, the same concerns with Jesus, him wrestling with the hour that is coming, but he's done it previously in the Gospel of John. And so as we arrive in Gethsemane, in the Gospel of John, it's a very different scene. Apparently, this olive grove was someplace that Jesus went regularly because Judas knew that this would be the place to find him. It's almost like Jesus habitually went here, that he would come, that this was a place maybe where he spent time, could have prayed, you know, like we see in all of the other gospels. And yet, here, Judas knows exactly where Jesus is at. So as Judas comes into the garden, he brings with him some soldiers, most likely both Roman and Jewish, officials from the temple, Sadducees, and the Pharisees. These are the traditional enemies of Jesus throughout all of the Gospels, who are now coming to arrest him in the garden where he has been with his disciples. So seeing this crowd coming his way with the torches, lanterns, and weapons, Jesus goes to face them head on. And then he says, "Who are you looking for?" And they respond that they are looking for Jesus of Nazareth. Many of your translations say that Jesus responds with, "I am he." But the underlying Greek carries a ton of weight in this instance, because Jesus says, "Ego eimi," I am. This is Jesus invoking the divine name in the moment of arrest. So in the garden, as these armed soldiers come to take Jesus away, those who have been plotting to kill Jesus for chapters now, they come to take him away finally with weapons in hand, and they ask for him, and he declares, "I am." And what do? The armed mob that has come to arrest him, led by the one who betrays him, including all of the groups that have wanted to kill Jesus throughout the entire gospel, what do they do in this moment? Those who have come to arrest Jesus, upon hearing him declare, "I am," draw back and fall to the ground. They fall into a posture of worship. This moment where Jesus declares, I am he, I am," they fall to the ground in a posture of worship. Those who have come to arrest Jesus and ultimately to see him dead, they have been brought to their knees in front of him, and they have been so stunned that Jesus has to shake them out of their stupor in order for them to be able to even arrest him. And it's in this moment that we see Peter rise up, draw a sword, and cut off the right ear of Malchus, one of the high priest's servants. And so we get a ton of details about who is hurt, what happens. Jesus immediately says, "Put away your sword. Should I not drink the cup my Father has for me?" So frequently, as we look at this passage, we're really focused on the fact that Peter's denial of Jesus, which Jesus prophesied, is really just on the horizon. But what I don't want us to lose sight of is the fact that in this moment, Peter was willing to risk his life to defend Jesus. But Jesus makes it clear that he is operating from the wrong paradigm. Peter is thinking, "This is my Messiah. I need to draw my sword and defend him." And Jesus is making it clear that the Father has a different cup for him to drink. And that changes everything. So rather than encouraging violence, Jesus is calling his followers in this moment to lay down their weapon and to trust in God that he will work through them the things that need to happen. After they're finally able to get up off the ground, the people who have come to arrest Jesus take him to Annas. And we might wonder, well, why not Caiaphas? Because we've already been told that Caiaphas is the high priest, and Annas is not the high priest. But Annas had been appointed high priest in AD 6 and had served as high priest until AD 15, according to Josephus, the Jewish historian. And then the Romans decided that he was too influential, they wanted him out of power, and so the Roman governor who preceded Pilate had him removed from power. And because the high priest serves for life within Judaism in the same way that the Pope serves for life within Catholicism, the expectation was that really Annas would continue to serve throughout the remainder of his life as the high priest. And so he's given an honorary title here in this interaction with Jesus that he is referred to as the high priest by John. And he's not mistaken. Annas had been high priest, and this is an honorary title. I mean, if football coaches in the NFL who go on to be commentators can then be referred to as coach, then it's understandable that somebody who had served as the high priest for the nation of Israel was then removed illegally in their minds from office and would continue to be influential in the city. It makes sense that he would be referred to as high priest. And no matter what, Annas is the patriarch who had 5 sons and 1 son-in-law who followed him as high priest in Jerusalem. So he remained influential no matter what. He is a key figure in the life of Judaism during this time frame. From a historical perspective, it makes a ton of sense for someone like Annas to serve in this role for Caiaphas, right? If he continues to have influence and power and wealth, and he is trying to shield Caiaphas from any potential backlash that might come as a result of taking out a key figure like Jesus, then Annas can vet the process. He can step in, hear Jesus out, and it doesn't take much. It takes like 1 sentence from the lips of Jesus for him to determine that Jesus must die. He reminds them that he has done all of his ministry in the open, in the synagogue, in the temple. He has done nothing in secret, and now they're bringing him in for a trial in secret. He is calling them into question, their processes into question, and then he does something that catches them all off guard, and that is he calls them to testify. Throughout so much of the Gospel of John, who testifies to Jesus? John the Baptist, his works, his word, the Father, right? That has been at the heart of Jesus's contention with the Jews. And now he's before Annas, a former high priest who's functioning on behalf of Caiaphas, the current high priest. The high priest who we know prophetically, according to the Gospel of John, has said that it's better for one person to die for the nation than the entire nation to perish. Throughout so much of the Gospel of John, at the heart of Jesus's contention with the Jewish leadership has been who bears witness to his works and his word. And so John the Baptist was a witness. The works that Jesus has done are a witness. The word that Jesus preaches is a witness. The Heavenly Father is a witness. And now as Jesus stands before a former high priest, he calls him to testify. Jesus is saying, look, who are those that accuse me? Why don't they testify as to why I'm being crucified? And in that moment, they would have to confess the works and the word that Jesus has already done. In this final segment, Peter is brought back into focus, and we're told that a family member of the man whose ear Peter has cut off, someone that was in the garden, recognizes him, calls him out, and then Peter, in the face of that, denies Jesus, and the rooster crows.